Okay. Okay, could we start, please? Could we please start? As some of you know, I've been inviting artists to come and talk here, I think, for over a dozen years now. And this year, there are just two speakers this term. Nowadays, it's under the general rubric of art and architecture. You work out the architecture, the artist does the art for you. And we have Pierre-Jean Giloux as our guest today. I want to say just a very few words before he begins his talk. He has a longish talk and four films to do. Pierre-Jean Giloux has made four films jointly titled Invisible Cities. He made them between 2010 and 2015. In these films, he recreates four Japanese cities. Recreates is not really the right word for these works, a better way of putting it, and of course, the talk will fully enlighten you on this, is to say that he invents them. His work describes a metamorphosis of the actual toward the virtual. This labor of his was conducted in each of the four cities over an extended period of time. His project developed out of the histories of buildings, built or dreamed of, and his own experience of Japan. Sound is important in these films. He has worked closely with the composer Lionel Marchetti. I hope this is correct. You worked with Lionel Marchetti?
Yes.
Yes. Sound paces the progress within the landscape as Marchetti records sound at the same time that the photographs are taken and the video is made. Pierre-Jean Giloux's work has been shown in more places than I can cover here. Some of them, Pompidou Center in Paris, the Thalia Art Foundation in Brussels, in Normandy, in Hong Kong, in Japan, in galleries and as part of film festivals. His next exhibition will be in Lisbon early next year. And in September 2017, he will show at the Barbican here in London as part of an exhibition titled Into the Unknown. Please welcome Pierre-Jean.
So thank you very much. I will try to do my best with my English, so excuse me. So the name is Machinami, Japanese Urban Landscapes. I willingly talk about enigma when I remind myself of what Japan represents for me. And I keep on thinking this country is an enigma. I am very fond of Chris Marker's quotation to invent Japan is a way to know it. I discovered Japan for the first time in 1996 because of a residency, the Marunouma Art Residency, located in Saitama, northwest of Tokyo. The duration of the residency was pretty long, 6 months. It allowed me to emerge myself to discover this country. Initially, I had to unlearn to put all my reflexes, my behaviors, on all value system in order to understand what I was discovering. It was a radical questioning of my knowledge. This state disrupted my way of working and maybe my way of being. Unable to speak Japanese, I could only rely on trust in my intuition. Moreover, I had to sharpen my senses. In 1996, the internet was not here yet, and its communication modes either. We were, therefore, still bound to this idea of displacement through distance, and in consequence, a certain slowness in the discovery of this country. At that time, I was working with video and sculpture. Space, volume, and image have always been my main concern, and discovering Japan was an incredible shock. The abundance of sound and images, cadenced by sound and blaring music, contrasted with Paris, which in comparison appeared dim and nearly silent. The buildings shared the spatial organization of the city were so new to me. I seen that a feeling of freedom arose from the ordered chaos. While traveling between Tokyo and Fukuoka, I stopped at Hiroshima and visited the Peace Museum built by Kenzo Tange. I was extremely moved when I saw it, and it remains present in my mind. Later, I discovered the work of Arata Isozaki, titled Ruined Hiroshima, conceived for the 1968 Milano Triennale. I was immediately struck by it. Isozaki had projected picture of his megastructures onto a photographic panel of the destroyed city. When taking of rings, Isozaki used an important metaphor. I quote, "Ruins are dead architecture. Their complete image has been lost. In order to recreate this image from the remaining fragments, imagination is necessary. In his devastated landscape, two big architectural shapes emerge. Two megastructures hang over this fallen city. Looking for more information, I discovered the metabolists. They were planning to rebuild the country to fashion it anew. They created radical solutions to structure the rapid out-of-control post-war growth. I was an impetus towards the future, a future spatial and urban development that had to respond to the movement of the population towards cities. This was trigger for me. In 2013, coming back to Japan after a few years, on a nighttime ride from Narita Airport to Tokyo Station, I was struck by the illuminated stretches created by the facades of buildings. The outdoor lighting of social housing blocks created strange vertical lines like spatial punctuations, which at night generated an electrical score similar to the Braille alphabet. This strong visual experience triggered the desire to use tracking spots in order to recreate these graphical landscapes, which disappeared at dawn. Connecting the writing of Braille with the disappearance gave me the idea for the title, What Would Become the Tetralogy Invisible Cities? Metabolism. I started filming and taking pictures of the remaining metabolism structure in Tokyo. The first discovery was in the neighborhood of Shinjuku, with the surprising new sky building by Yuji Watanabe. Then in the neighborhood of Shinbashi, where two famous architectures stand alongside each other, the Nagakin Capsule Hotel by Kisho Kurokawa and the Shizuka Press and Broadcasting Tower by Kenzo Tange. This sharpened my curiosity and I started to study metabolism in greater detail. In the 1960s, the metabolist movement brought together a group of town planners, architects, and Japanese artists. The critic and theorist Noboru Kawazoe, architect Kyonori Kikutake, Masato Otaka, Kisho Kurokawa, Fumihiko Maki, the designer Kenji Ekuan, and the graphic designer Kiyoji Awazu. They shared the same vision, a city of the future. When they're in line with traditional ideology, referencing the iconic image, the vast Shinto sanctuary of Ise. Every 3 years, this sanctuary is rebuilt on its own image. The traditions and instruction of the reconstructions, which are extremely precise, have been passed on via a series of texts back from the 10th century. The actual building from 2013 are the 60 seconds that have been reconstructed. Sorry. The Metabolist Manifesto, 1960s, the proposal for new urbanism, was published on the occasion of the World Conference Design Conference Center in Tokyo that same year. I had several specific features. It was able to extend as a vast scale, to be flexible, and to have an extensive structure, making possible a process of organic growth. It was a response to the influx of people towards urban center. The main concepts were mobility and the construction of cluster nomadic dwellings that could be assembled or disassembled and that had a significant influence of archigram plugging cities. Metabolism was the last modernist utopia from the 20th century. This discovery fascinated me and prompted the desire to make these films, this project. I kept on filming this neighborhood and little by little things started to be more precise. The proximity of this architecture to Tokyo Bay gave me the idea of choosing this geographical area as the stage of the movie. The project of mixing historical layers on contemporary Tokyo seemed to be an interesting idea to develop. To dream a city, to revolve a city by creating an anachronism. That was the challenge of this project. According to the art historian Daniel Arras, one possible definition of anachronism is take an ancient object out of its period to make it live today in relation to contemporary questions. I must say that intuitively, I had acted like that from the beginning. For more details for Metabolism, you can refer to the book Project Japan, written in collaboration with Rem Koolhaas and Ansel Rochebrist. It's a book made of rare and fascinating interviews on the catalog from the Moreart Museum titled Metabolism, the City of the Future. So I want to project the first film. So the name is Metabolism. Something like 11 minutes, and after I will continue to speak about the second film. So Metabolism is the first film of the tetralogy Invisible Cities. It was the first show, it was first shown in the exhibition Wabi Sabi Shima in Brussels in 2015. Metabolism is not a documentary, rather it falls under the category of fiction. It stages in contemporary Tokyo some elements of the past which were only outlined and never built. I choose two specific projects, Helix City from Kishoku Arakawa, 1961, and Cluster and the Air, Shibuya from Arata Isozaki, 1962. Even though Arata Isozaki was never officially a member of the Metabolism group, he had started his career in 1954 in the office of Kenzo Tange, his old professor who was the most influential architect of the post-war period. Isozaki was inspired by Kenzo Tange's proposal to design a construction of several levels above the city, and by his urban projects, like many young architects, at that time. I quote, "By incorporating special elements, speed and extreme change, within the built environment, we created a changeable and elastic method of structuring. Cluster in the Air and his proposal for a new type of drilling built above the existing city was inspired by traditional wooden Japanese architecture by its bracketing system used, for example, on the Great Southern Door of the Todaiji in Nara." Can't show you this. Thanks. The Todaiji, the Eastern Great Temple, is a Buddhist temple. Its unique monumentality embodies the Shōmu political ideal, a centralized state based on the Buddhism. It shelters an enormous bronze statue of Buddha titled Daibutsu, the Great Buddha. Arata Isozaki reused the pillar and the load-bearing structures of the roof and transposed them at the urban scale. It could be compared to the Klaus Oldenburg sculpture in his process on its final results. Within the Metabolism movement, I established links between essential Japanese cultural elements, such as the petals of cherry tree flowers, and Metabolism cluster, a fruit inspired by Noboru Kawazoe. The structural element is conceived like the organization of an arbor. Architectural shapes are modified according to the movement of units that they come and go. Kishoku Rokawa created a set of units whose general appearances can be modified by rearranging each part. When talking about Nagakin Capsule Hotel, I quote, "It is a set of units that can be modified. The general appearance changes according to be various units of combination, similar to this to the MoveNet system. Diagram of the evolution of the sky house, for example, by Kyunori Kikutake. Among the metabolists, and especially for Kishoku Okawa, there was a desire for a symbiosis between the fragment and the whole. Temporalities. Kurokawa regularly introduced the notion of temporality in his architecture. He believed that each building is given a shape in relation to the present time. Each building reflects the spirit of its era. For the metabolist, each period, the past, the present, and the future, needs to be incorporated into one unique and single architectural space. For Kurokawa, time was not perceived as a linear continuity, but rather the images of different periods would be intermixed like rhizomes. The notion of metamorphosis, a central metabolist concept, was linked to another essential concept that of temporality. To quote Kurokawa, time cannot be perceived as a linear evolution, but must be understood as a series of autonomous fragments, like floating particles in space. And more, to imagine time as a pure necklace or an helicoidal DNA structure or the shape of a vase that needs to be put back together using shards. Kurokawa used the concept of diachronicity, which means that one can consider past, present, or future as equidistant periods in relation to one's own location. For example, the architecture of the capsule summer modular residency K conveys as an image of advancing technology. It embodies a symbiosis by coating a tea room of the Edo period by Kobori and Shu. Kisho Kurokawa, a critic of functionalism architecture, created a philosophical approach to architecture and urbanism based on a life principle rather than on the era of the machine. He wished to achieve a symbiosis between past, present, and future, believing that symbiosis would triumph and replace the universality ideal of the machine era. And all these notions that I have mentioned up to now are very similar to the ideas that govern the making of the film. Time, duration, fragment, all. I would like now to read a text by Robert Bresson about his work as a filmmaker. I see several connections that can be established with this text. Robert Bresson. Beautiful image and abstraction. From painting, I only use general rules and completely intuitively, I turn my back on every that could refer to a painting or a beautiful picture. That is to say, I flee from a beautiful image. I am not looking for an attractive photograph. I am looking for necessary photographs. That is not the same thing. However, it is evident that if you wish to move a film audience, the image has to be ordered, as all the elements of the film have to be ordered. Thus, it becomes because to be concerned by composition, this is my habitual concern, and not the search of a beautiful image. Among the questions we have raised, there lies the question of abstraction. What does the word abstract mean? I believe it means to cut off a part from a whole in order to scrutinize it on its own. To be abstract is exactly what cinema must do, that is to say, not to show things in their usual connection, in their usual relationship in daily life, but rather take the part of a whole, single them out, and put them back together in a specific order. So if I am abstract, I am pleased about it, because this is my only concern, not to take character in its entirety, but if it's a person, look at the relationship between hands and face, and an object, and recreate links that are personal, related to my own life, my inner life. That is to say, not to show to the audience what I see, but to get the audience to feel what I feel. This is not the same thing. A film is not made of images, but of relationship between images. These relationships must create life in a similar way to colors in painting. A blue is blue, but if you put it close a yellow, it's not the same blue. A film is not only made of picture, but also of sound and rhythm. That is to say, you have to move your audience with format elements. Paul Valéry used to say, form has a value of unity, end quote. I was interested in talking about metabolism using Bresson philosophy, in evoking its philosophy and making it the very principle of the film constructions. So, there is three aspects. Maybe I finished with this one.
We decided that I would read it to get Bird read faster than he does.
And I know the text. Okay, so his last line was, I was interested in talking about metabolism using Brisson's philosophy, in invoking its philosophy and making it the very principle of the film's construction. There are three aspects to this. Temporality. The introduction of the film is a long sequence shot playing with color variations leading from an aerial state, petals spinning and flying in a clear sky, to a watery state, keeping the camera's viewpoint still. Color helps us to traverse spaces. It concerns passage. From a still shot positioned towards the sky, a low angle shot, we gradually turn into a top shot. Does that mean an aerial shot? Yeah, aerial shot. Revealing a faraway stretch of water with metabolist architectures above it. So from a frontal space, to a space with a horizon, and therefore a perspective. Japanese culture is the second aspect. Reusing distinctive elements, such as the petals, for example, and by creating reciprocity between the petals and the nomadic modules, referencing the clusters. The group's theorist, Noboru Kawazoe, explains that for the metabolists, the structural element is conceived as a tree, a permanent element with dwelling units, the leaves, ephemeral elements that fall and renew themselves according to the needs of the moment. The buildings will be able to grow from that structure, die, and be reborn again, but the structure will remain. And the third aspect, metamorphosis. As it happens, the petals also change in a symbolic fashion. During the night sequence, the constant rain of the petal of the cherry tree becomes little by little a sort of threat made of particles. This is due to the sound environment. At the end of the film, the natural sound of the wind evolves into crackling sounds like a Geiger counter. Here I am alluding both to the Grove of the Fireflies by Iso Takahata and to the Fukushima accident. So do you want the second film now?
キーは生育することを。
Okay, what I'm reading concerns the film you've just seen. It's called Traveling with the Wind. In this film, I decided to use the egg of wind, an oval geometrical structure of 16 by 8 meters, covered by perforated aluminium panels designed by Toyo Ito in 1989. Initially conceived as a futuristic house, the egg of wind would light up at night through the video images projected onto 5 liquid crystal screens located inside. The capsule can be found in Tokyo, River City 21. It is attached to a wall which is suspended from the ground by metal feet. From 1961 to 1970, Toyo Ito's worked with Kiyonori Kitutake. From Kitutake, he took the notion of constructive imagination, and from Arata Isozaki, the notion of design freedom. Toyo Ito is famous for being a deconstructive architect. It does not mean deconstruction, but rather fragmentation, taking apart each different element of the composition. Egg of Wind and the Tower of Wind were realized during the third period, titled The Electronic Fleas Garden, from 1986 to 1998. First period was the Lights Garden from 71 to 83. Second period, Winds Garden from 84 to 91. The third period, Electronic Fleas Garden from 86 to 98. And nowadays, Contemporary Period from 1999 till today. For Japan principle, Egg of Wind becomes a conveyor or a vehicle floating in the air and linking during its journey with all the various chosen architectures from Tokyo to Yokohama. They are spatial crossings, where some architectures will mutate. The beginning of the film, the second shot, starts with an opening movement. I make reference here to a Japanese architectural element, the soji's sliding doors. Applying the principle to an entire building creates an impact on the surrounding built environment. So a movement created by the facade allows us to catch a glimpse of a neighborhood into which the camera dives and which we will discover later. Distortions. The other iconic architecture taken up in the film is the Mode Gakuen Cocoon Tower located in Shinjuku. I chose to work on flow and movement using the architectural and artistic qualities of the architecture. In this shot, I highlighted its flexibility, its woven aspect. The meshing undergoes distortion. Egg of Wind will slip through its meshes to find itself in daytime in the area of Shinjuku, and it will be able to pursue its wandering. This sequence gives us a sense of another urban reality made of distortions, folds, and shifts. For Toyo Ito, the wind and its significance are important, not only because the architecture, and even more his urban sculptures, are characterized by lightness and transparency, but also because he interacts with the environment and the user. The wind tower, built in Yokohama in 1986, will be the place where the various eggs of wind will get together. The reconstruction is made from digital images using photographic documentation. In this architecture, Ito has developed all the possibilities offered by electronic. Tower of Wind is his first public building, a ventilation tower and a water tank for an underground shopping center. At night, electrical elements transform the tower into a light signal made of strips, which constantly change according to the winds, thanks to the computer's uninterrupted calculations. By staging, reconstructing, and playing with architectural elements, Japan Principle, the film, invites us to travel and discover buildings which are historical milestones. We discover the stunning red and silver Aoyama Technical College, the K Museum by Makoto Sei Watanabe, an inactive museum built on the artificial island of Odaiba. This contemporary ruin, this survivor of the 90s real estate bubble, is witness to a period where the most daring projects could be built. Then the impressive new sky building by Yoshi Watanabe, a vestige of metabolism, surprises us with its audacity and anachronism. The appearance of the Sana white building located in Aoyama is a rendering of the impression it made on me when I saw it for the first time. A ghost pierced with windows opening onto the sky. Tokyo Station in Shibuya, now demolished and about to be rebuilt, was a place without much architectural quality. Even so, it was a functional place, a passage where millions of commuters would intersect. Japan Principle is a fiction, which nonetheless draws closer to urban archaeology. On the ground, a different beat, the city of Tokyo with its constant human and traffic flows, its numerous billboards and light signals gives rhythm to the evasive present, a pure energy. Defining the relation between architecture and the city, Ito uses the metaphor of the river. Quote, "When you look at a river, you become aware that it is being crossed by opposite currents, which are not strong enough to oppose the river. It creates whirlpools, that is to say, mobile and definite zones, moving in the direction of the river, but without ceasing to be themselves." Architecture might be about creating ephemeral whirlpools whose form is shaped by their motion.
Okay, I want to show you some picture from the exhibitions, different spaces, for example. It was in the Kyoto Art Center the last year for metabolism. So it was only one projection in a very big space. And the second part of the exhibition was Japan Principle. And I had the opportunity to make an installation in the tea room in the Kyoto Art Center. So I was playing, of course, with the shoji, with the doors, and with the reflection with the glass. And it was quite interesting, the interaction between the projections and the space. It was totally, it was a meeting between images and space. It was very interesting. So we will see the next third film, Shrinking Cities.
木々は生育することのない無数の目を見、根を張り、枝や葉を広げて固体と種の保存には有り余るほどの養分を吸収する。木々はこの溢れんばかりの過剰を使うことも、 享受することもなく自然に返すが、動物はこの溢れる養分を自由で聞きとした自らの運動に使用する。このように自然はその初限から生命の無限の展開に向けての序曲を奏でている。物質としての束縛を少しずつ断ち切り、やがて自らの姿を自由に変えていくので、
So, Shrinking Cities. To make this movie, I carefully read Tokyo University Towns Planning Studies, led by Hidotachi Ono. The results of this research were published in a book, Tokyo 2050, Fiber City. That was the point of departure of our fiction. If the planning of the capital city were lead of the development of the transport infrastructure and mobility for economic growth, Fiber City will build around an aging population that will have consequences for the spatial organization of the city. I quote, "The industrial outsourcing, the drastic decrease of the population in 2050, there will be up to 35 or 40 million people less. And the Fukushima accident will have a massive effect on the appearance of the megapolis. The string of large stations around Tokyo will become mini satellites around the zone formed by the Yamanote Line. This tracking shot is made of photographs, video, and digital images. Its making involves the juxtaposition of various types of images in an attempt to be as realistic as possible and in order to recreate and refabricate landscape. I was inspired by Emakimono, literally translated painting to be wrapped. In an horizontal shape, it is narrative and illustrated and was created during the 11th century to the 16th in Japan. This video allows me to approach a purely prospective aspect. This tracking shot extends from the center of Tokyo toward its periphery. In other words, for an identifiable point in the present towards in an indeterminate future, from a real Tokyo towards new virtual cityscapes. The architecture disappears gradually to make way for science. This is no longer a built city, but a multiply sitting city made of billboards of movement and only with light. Shrinking Cities, like the set of films which have up the tetralogy, plays with temporalities, with translation from nighttime to daytime or vice versa. It reveals little by little the future transformation of a urban landscape, the evolution of a town planning which is divided into zones of variable densities. Buildings gradually turn white, empty, like empty shells emitting meekly light. The city loses its substance. The sound of the shepherd scale, an auditory illusion, creates the impression of a town slowing down to infinity. At daybreak, we arrive at Osaka Station. This shrinking city's phenomenon is not confined to Japan. It affects every industrial country, and Europe does not escape to this urban mutation. I will show you the first time I show this work in an installation in Japan in Yokohama. So I had this house and I put this yellow plastic, you know, for blind person all over the space. And in the first room you can see the landscapes by night. I use for making my films after. And it was a map from fiction, Tokyo to Osaka. And you can go to the space, and on the space you just have sound and nothing to see because the film is there, and you just have to, you can see the film only with the holes, through the holes. and it gave me the idea to separate the sound from the images for the first time for me.
Possibly show the last film, which is 15 minutes. There's 5 minutes of text describing that last film, which I'll read out. It's called Stations, the fourth film. It is a real and a fictional journey taking place in the Kansai area in Japan, departing from Osaka towards Suita and Kyoto, then around the symbolic Lake Biwa. Omnipresent throughout, the liquid element opens and closes the film. Unlike the three other extremely urban movies, Stations gives a greater place to nature. The reconstructed journey starts with the discovery of Osaka and the Umeda neighborhood. Hiroshihara's Umeda sky building, with its oculus made of mirrors, operates to deconstruct the surrounding landscape. Like a zoetrope, it triggers the idea of putting into motion the urban landscape reflected at its heart. This movement set off a tracking shot inside Osaka City, bringing us into the northern suburb of Suita, where the famous Universal Exhibition of Osaka was opened in 1970. As the first Universal Exhibition in Asia, this event contributed to the shaping of the corporate image of Japan as a technological nation. We wander through a partial reconstruction of the exhibition, where one can find some of Kenzo Tange and Kisho Kurokawa's architecture, the luminous fountains of Isamu Noguchi, the Swiss and French pavilions, or the strange sun tower by the Japanese artist Taro Okamoto. This virtual break reviles sculpture and architecture similar to sci-fi works, reflecting the belief that technology would be the source of progress. This journey keeps going in the direction of Kyoto in a graphic universe, which again makes reference to the Japanese painted scrolls dating from the Nara period. Several historical layers, which also play with anachronism, appear within a natural and nocturnal landscape. At first, a pan over Kyoto Station reveals the facade of a building by Hiroshihara. Then a passage to the interior of this enormous ship reveals a huge atrium in which stands an LED screen. This screen shows the original plan of Kyoto at a time when the city was called Hayankyo, a Chinese name created by the Japanese, which means capital of peace and security. A historical review tries to show how Kyoto was constructed, showing its grid plan. Hayanaka was founded in 794. The builders of this imperial city were inspired by the regular plan of the Chinese city of Chang'an, 617, consisting of arteries, networks north, south, and east, west, intersecting at right angles. Kyoto is only one of the cities written according to the principle of the grid pattern. I compared this plan to video games developed by Nintendo, located not far from Kyoto, at the level of graphics and sound. On the last journey, we are heading towards Kyoto International Conference Center, built by the metabolist Sachio Tani, where the Kyoto Protocol was signed. A zoom in on Horai Mountain, and we travel towards Lake Biwa, going back up its famous canals. This lake and its area were the stage of the birth of modern Japan. Like Lake Biwa, enabled the economic growth of Kyoto, and it still remains today the biggest natural water reserve of Japan. I chose this space, which has been shot before, to design a virtual lakeside city, the Biwako Machi. A collaboration with the architect Manuel Tarditz for Mikan Architects, located in Yokohama, began with the design of this city. We exchanged documents and ideas to create these architectures. The camera moves above the water, passes through a symbolic passage, and comes gently closer to these floating, slender architectures. These futuristic buildings are a reminder of the first images of metabolism, as if we had achieved a complete revolution. The traveling cycle can start again. The last image, triggered by a glittering wake, the perspective seems to open. Okay, if there are any questions, we've got 5 or 10 minutes.
I can maybe show the research from with Manuel. We have an exchange from photographs, and I do diptychs to do this town. And I show you the last installation. It's currently in France. It's Invisible Cities. So it's four screens. One in a box behind, and theme are playing in the same time. The screens are different size, and 1 meter, 2 meters, 50, and 4 meter, 50 high. So.
All right. Are there any questions? Is there a mic going on?
So after seeing all your research on the metabolism movement and something that you had discovered when you went to Japan like almost 20 years ago, I see your films and it is almost like these metabolism projects that you have researched, you have placed them in modern day Tokyo and you have almost made them a reality through your films. And the question is, was your intention of making these metabolism projects a reality in film because of the fact that you wanted to see them in Tokyo in reality through this film, or because you believe that Japan as a whole could be a society that today could be having these architectural features within them?
Yeah, I don't know if you understood.
Yes, I think I understand, but okay, right. I think that I would like to try to show that it was a desire for society to exprime with the forms something like a social moment. I think that Isozaki, for example, construct one model like a cluster, but I think it's no sense, you know, because it's just an object, and I think it was something in Arabic countries. I don't know where exactly, but it was for me that was an unbelievable story. This metabolism group, because they believe in some things, and even if you have no project with the society, I think it's, we have nothing to do with that, you know. It's not interesting because, for example, I don't know, you can construct this kind of things, of course, now it's possible, but no, it was like a dream that I want to import in the present. Yes, just that.
Is there one very quick last question? Yes.
Hello. I wanted to ask a question about how you show your work, because the films are very otherworldly. They're almost dreamlike. And there's this kind of relationship with the cinema and how, or at least the cinematic format and this idea of collective dreaming. And I wonder, it seems to me from the images you've shown of some of the exhibitions, that you actually play with that much more. Here, for example, showing multiple screens and at different heights around the room, they seem to me very apt to be shown quite simply in the cinematic format because of their dreamlike state. So I wonder, the question is, to what extent does showing your work enter your mind when you're tasked with having to show it?
Petite traduction, la fin surtout. Just the end of the question.
Le cinéma, c'est un espace collectif, de rêve collectif. Comment est-ce que vous pensez de ces écrans et l'idée de rêve collectif?
Je ne sais pas si je comprends bien, mais... Ok. You mean... How I exhibit this? How I the idea for that?
Not specifically this, but generally, how much do you think about how you exhibit the film? The film itself is constructed very much.
Yes.
How do you then think about how you show it in an exhibition or a show?
Okay, for me, for this project especially. I used to think that, yes, I think that I had this idea and I would like to, I thought about an installation since the beginning, you know, because cinema is cinema, but I used to be a sculptor too, and space is very important for me, and a space where you show you exhibit your work is also important. So for me, it's important to take care about where I am invited, for example, especially for this space, and to give to the space attentions and try to mix together what I do with where I am. You know, it's for example when I show you the pictures. And the ceremony tea room in Japan, it was perfect because it was exactly what I want. Here, it's in the church. It's for me. I don't expect anything from a church. But what I thought when I saw the space for the first time, I just saw that it was very high. And I never thought before that I would like to make an installation with different, you know, levels. So a space can determine how I make my work or how I exhibit my work. And for the films, they are independent films, and I can project directly films in the cinema or festivals. So you can you touch different persons, you know. You can touch persons from court métrage, so short films, and persons from I think contemporary art, because I come from contemporary art and not from cinema at the beginning.
All right, so. Just remains to thank you for.
Thank you very much.
I'm exhausted reading the lips. My mouth's gone quite dry.
Inspiring to see an artist that puts so much research, like